बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ इनऑर्गेनिक मटेरियल केमिस्ट्री कैम 3115 एंड दिस इज़ सेकंड लेक्चर ऑन हाइड्रोथर्मल सिंथेसिस मेथड। दिस इज़ 35th लेक्चर ऑफ दिस कोर्स एंड आफ्टर दिस लेक्चर we will have an other lecture on hydrothermal synthesis, that will be hydrothermal synthesis third lecture, and after that your course will finish. So dear students, the key concepts of this lecture includes, we will talk about organic inorganic hybrid materials and some basic concepts about interactions between organic and inorganic materials. In this lecture we will also discuss experimental method. What is actually hydrothermal synthesis method? How we do the experiment? And during experimental method, the most important, we use autoclaves. We will discuss some properties of autoclaves. Then we will talk about main factors which govern the solvothermal crystal growth, and finally new trends in solvothermal crystal growth processes will be discussed by giving some examples which are related to hydrothermal or solvothermal synthesis methods. So starting from organic inorganic hybrid materials, we can synthesize a certain kind of organic solid by using hydrothermal method, or we can synthesize inorganic solid by using hydrothermal method, or we can synthesize organic and inorganic hybrid material. So organic inorganic hybrid materials represent the interaction between the two major branches of chemistry, means organic chemistry and inorganic chemistry. Each of these branches importantly contribute to the material science, and have characteristic properties that induce various advantages and limitations. The most commonly used definition for organic inorganic hybrid materials can be that a hybrid material is a material that includes two moieties blended on the molecular scale. Two moieties means two different materials. For example, if the hybrid material is organic inorganic hybrid material, then the two moieties will be organic moiety and inorganic moiety. So commonly one compound is inorganic and the other one is organic in nature. We know that the organic compounds have characteristic properties. Similarly, inorganic compounds, they also have characteristic properties. So we develop hybrid materials to take the advantage of the best properties of each component while eliminating their particular limitations and produce new materials with new properties. So by engineering organic inorganic hybrid materials, we can attain both properties which are shown by organic materials as well as by inorganic materials. Although the original birth of hybrid materials are not known exactly, the mixing of organic and inorganic components was carried out in ancient world, but at the end of the 20th and at the beginning of 21st century, Hybrid materials attracted scientists' attention because of their availability of novel physicochemical characterization methods, and the field of nanoscience opened many points of view for approaches of new materials. Organic inorganic hybrid materials are very simple materials, and simple processes can be used to design these materials on molecular level so that these materials can be applied in many branches of chemistry, especially materials chemistry, because of the different mechanical and physical properties which are present in these materials. Among these properties, chemical activity is the main property of the hybrid materials. They bind the chemical activity of their constituents by exploring their ionic conductivity, selectivity, luminescence, electrical and optical properties, chemical or biochemical activity. These properties can be used in selective membranes, batteries, sensors, electrochemical devices, electrochemical supercapacitors. These properties can also be used in catalysis and in photochemical energy conversion cells. So we can say that the properties of organic inorganic hybrid materials are so much, and they can be used in many of materials chemistry branches. Hybrid materials can be classified by using their field of application or their chemical nature. So first of all, Judenstein classified the hybrid materials based on the interactions between the organic and inorganic interface and the selected interactions, which are illustrated in some figure later. So these classifications has two types. Type 1, it means weak interactions between two phases. It includes van der Waals forces, hydrogen bonding, or weak electrostatic interactions. The second type includes strong chemical interactions between the compounds. This classification is very simple, but it helps the first prediction to categorize the complication of a wide variety of systems. Because hybrid materials include a wide range of organic and inorganic parts, generally inorganic part involves transition metal oxides or p-block elements, and organic part involves organic diamine ligands. Organic component can affect the microstructure of inorganic oxide part by controlling the nucleation and growth of the inorganic oxide. Maybe you have learned about organometallic compounds or metallo-organic compounds, or maybe you will learn in next semesters. So organometallic compounds means the one of the part of the compound is organic part, and metallo means there can be certain metal like transition metal. So this is why they are called organometallic, and they are kind of hybrid materials where both of the things are present, like an organic moiety and also an inorganic moiety. So there is synergistic interaction between these two parts of hybrid materials. This gives information about organic and inorganic structures. Additionally, more complex phases can be produced by a shift from thermodynamic to kinetic domain rather than equilibrium phases, and secondary metal complexes are used to cause more complex structures. These secondary metal complexes make bridges between the metal oxide and organic component that cannot bond directly to metal oxide. There are various modes of involvement of organonitrogen components in metal oxide structures. These are space filling structure directing, charge compensating, ligand bound to a strict secondary metal site, ligand bound directly to a metal oxide. So these structures are illustrated in figure 1. So in figure 1, we can see different kind of interactions which are mentioned in two types of organic and inorganic hybrid materials. Type 1 is weak interaction between two phases, which includes van der Waals, hydrogen bonding, or weak electrostatic. And the type 2 means strong chemical interactions. So here you can see that this is the strength of interaction. From bottom to top, it is increasing. Van der Waal forces are too much weak, so their strength is very low. Hydrogen bonding is a little stronger. Van der Waals forces. So this is why hydrogen bonding has a little more strong interaction. And then in case of organic inorganic hybrid materials, ionic bonds can form and their strength is more as compared to hydrogen bonding. Students, here you must be careful about watching this slide, that the ionic strength is less as compared to coordinate or covalent strength. It does not mean that the ionic bond is weaker as compared to covalent. Here we are talking about metal organic interaction, or we are talking about organic inorganic interaction. Then the covalent bonding has the highest strength. So these are different strengths of organic inorganic hybrid materials. Generally, inorganic part involves transition metal oxide or P block elements, and organic part involves a ligand. So this is figure 2, different functions of organonitrogen compounds, charge compensating. The figure A is showing charge compensating. The B ligand bound directly to metal oxide. The C ligand bound to a secondary metal site. D is the ligand that is on secondary metal bonded to the metal oxide structure. And E is bridging ligand between the secondary metal complexes. So all of these organic inorganic interactions, organic inorganic hybrid materials, they can be synthesized by using hydrothermal method. So what is actually the experimental method? When we do hydrothermal method, what actually happens in hydrothermal method? So in hydrothermal method, the apparatus which is used is autoclaves. What are the autoclaves? What kind of material is used to make the autoclaves, and what are their properties? Because in hydrothermal method, the experimental method is very simple. We just take the reactants and we dissolve them, or we just mix them with a solvent and then place them into an autoclave. After that, the autoclave is sealed and is placed in an oven or in a furnace at a certain temperature. An autogenous pressure is developed when the temperature increases. When the temperature increases above the boiling temperature of the solvent. The autoclaves which are used for the crystal synthesis and growth under hydrothermal conditions, they produce a pressure that is required for the synthesis and growth of single crystals. So this is why it is also called a pressure vessel. And it is capable of containing highly corrosive solvent at high temperature and pressure. Highly corrosive means if we use a solvent and the solvent is very corrosive and it can react with the reaction vessel, then the autoclave is a reaction vessel which resists the reaction of the solvent or the material with the reaction vessel. The first autoclave was made in Europe alone in 19th century and used worldwide in the 20th century. An ideal autoclave for hydrothermal synthesis should include the following characteristics. First of all, it should be internally lined with the material which is inert to oxidizing agents, acids and bases, easy to operate and maintain. A suitable size and shape to obtain desired temperature gradient. It should be leak proof with unlimited capabilities to the required pressure and temperature. It should have high mechanical strength to bear high pressure and high temperature experiments for long duration. The most successful for material for autoclaves are corrosion resistance, high strength alloys such as stainless steel, iron, nickel, cobalt based super alloys and titanium and its alloys. In some hydrothermal reactions, the reagents and solvents are non-corrosive and the reactions can take place in autoclaves directly. However, in most of the hydrothermal experiments, the reagents and solvents are corrosive and they can attack the vessel in high temperatures and pressures. Thus, it requires a suitable lining for the inner wall of the autoclave. Students, when we talk about the corrosive solvents in hydrothermal synthesis, it means that some solvent other than water is added along with water into the autoclave. So we use a mixture of solvents, and the other component which is used along with water, it can be corrosive, it can react with the autoclave. So we do not use only the stainless steel autoclave in case if we are using a corrosive solvent, then we are using an inner lining. So in order to grow high purity crystals in highly corrosive environment, Teflon beakers or liners are used. The Teflon liner or beaker should sit exactly inside the autoclave without leaving any space. Students, maybe you know that Teflon is a material. It resists to any kind of acid. For example, if you play with hydrogen fluoride, hydrofluoric acid, it can react with glass, it can react with beakers, papers and other things which are made up of glass. So if you use Teflon made beaker, then HF will not react with Teflon. So it is very inert material. Teflon is an organic polymeric material. Teflon is the most popularly used lining material, but it cannot be used at more than 300 degrees Celsius temperature because Teflon dissociates, affecting the pH of unbuffered near neutral solutions above this temperature. The figures which are shown on the next slide, like figure 3, it shows autoclaves. The Teflon cannot be used above 300 degrees Celsius, and actually in hydrothermal synthesis mostly we use temperature between 150 to 300 degrees Celsius. Because of very high pressure and because of the low temperature, even it is higher than the boiling temperature of the solvent, we can get our desired product. So this is why it is not very dangerous to use Teflon in all of hydrothermal reactions, because we do not increase the temperature more than 300. There are rare chances we use the temperature more than 300 degrees Celsius. These are the pictures of stainless steel autoclaves and Teflon vessels. You can see this is a stainless steel autoclave and this is Teflon vessel. We place this Teflon vessel just inside this stainless steel autoclave as shown here, and then we use the cap to close it, and after that another cap is used to close whole of the autoclave. This Teflon and this cap of stainless steel both will be sealed. An ideal hydrothermal autoclave should have the following characteristics. It should be inert to acids, bases and oxidizing agents. It should be easily accessible and assemble and disassemble. It means it can easily be opened and closed. It should have sufficient length to obtain a desired temperature gradient. It should be leak proof and it should have high pressure and temperature bearing property. Here are some other pictures of autoclaves. You can see this is the autoclave and this is Teflon. So sometimes we use certain kind of rings to seal the autoclave. We can also use autoclave with the meter, which gives us information about the pressure. So for example, if we are inserting certain gas into the autoclave, we can have a lid from where we can control the solvent or the gas which is inserted into the autoclave, and on the other side a pressure meter can be used to measure the pressure on the autoclave. So in a typical chemical reaction, we just take the reactants, mix them into a solvent and then put into the autoclave, and after that we will place them into the autoclave and we will fix this autoclave, and this autoclave will be placed in a furnace or in an oven. Usually we use oven because oven can attain the temperature about 300 degrees Celsius or less than 300. So ovens are suitable for hydrothermal synthesis reaction. We do not need to use high temperature furnaces. Next are the main factors governing the solvothermal crystal growth. There are three factors: chemical factors, physical factors and kinetical factors. Chemical factors includes nature of solvent, nature of nutrient, nature of the seeds, the interaction between solvent and interaction between wall of the high pressure vessel. So the nature of solvent, what kind of solvent we are using and what kind of reactants are using. Are the reactants soluble in solvent? And what are the interactions of the solvent with the wall of the high pressure vessel? The physical factors are the crystal growth temperature, the temperature at which the crystal can grow, the pressure value, the temperature value, the hydrodynamics in the crystal growth system. And the kinetical factors can be the kinetics of dissolution, that we are dissolving a certain reactant into a solvent, the kinetic characterizing the diffusion of the chemical species, the crystal growth kinetics and the duration of the crystal growth. So dear students, There are some new trends in the crystal growth by using hydrothermal method, where we will discuss about crystal growth of oxides, crystal growth of non-oxides, similarly crystal growth of nanomaterials and some other properties. So we will also discuss some examples of hydrothermal synthesis, and these things will be discussed in the third lecture. This is all about this lecture. Inshallah, I will see you in the next lecture. Thank you very much.